In this video, we caught up with Colin, owner of the Happy Goblin Brewery, a small business producing craft beer in the northern suburbs of Sydney. We asked Colin to share a little about his journey going from small beginnings to scaling up. Colin's story is one of persistence and a love for making something, which makes it refreshing to realise that you can still start a business that makes a tangible product and be profitable in Australia.
G'day, I'm Colin from Happy Goblin Brewery, and this is my brewery. This is where I make beer. This is the brew house. We've got a mash tun, kettle up top. Hot water, cold water, packaging line, this is the fermenter room, primary fermenter and then maturing in these, my partner's fermenters as well. So this is where all the beer actually sits and becomes beer.
Yeah, what's in these glasses down there? What's going on there?
That's just beer maturing.
Maturing?
So yeah. It becomes beer in this.
Yeah.
And then it goes into them and that's where it matures and becomes drinkable.
Okay.
So it's not so good when it comes out of here.
not worthy of being drunk.
Well, not by anyone other than me. And then, that's it. That's where it becomes beer. And then once we're out of there, it gets packaged. Then it goes into kegs. And then it... That's the core room with all the kegs in there. They're almost empty at the moment.
Yeah.
Normally got like five times as many kegs in there as it does. So, yeah. Normally you can't even walk in there thanks to all the kegs. Yeah. Then after kegs, it gets put in bottles and send out, and that's it.
So what kind of beers are you brewing at the moment? What kind of other interesting stuff are you up to?
All the beers we make are ales, so I do a whole range of different ales, mostly just pale ale and a bitter are the main ones, and then also a strong ale and a dark ale and a ginger beer as well. Then we've also just started doing soft drinks as well. So they all go out. So most of them just go to one little place in Surry Hills. It's got them on tap and also in one of those new little food trucks that's driving around the city. Got them in kegs in there as well. So most of the beer goes out in bottles, but then we're also, like I was saying earlier, doing kegs as well. So we're trying to start to get into a few pubs like that.
What made you decide to start up your own business?
I didn't want to work for the man, and I studied chemistry and been making beer at home, so I thought, I reckon I could make beer and make some money out of it. I wanted to make something as well. I didn't want to just work in a job where you don't actually, where you actually got something in your hand that you hold at the end of it, some tangible product. So. And beer, everyone, basically,
Awesome. Did you find it hard to get going in the beginning?
It wasn't hard, but it was just very slow, and there was a lot of work, and just lots of bureaucracy, lots of things that you never think of before you get started until someone says, so have you got this license? I didn't have much time pressure on me, which was all right. That made it easier, but it took about a year longer than I expected to get started, and then about 3 years longer than I thought it was going to actually make some money.
And so how are you doing with that now? Are you profitable now?
Yeah, as of about 12 months ago.
So how long into your business since you started did you turn profitable, do you think?
5 years.
5 years.
Right. 6 years including setup.
Yeah.
So, 5 years of trading. But I started so small that there was no way. I knew that I couldn't make profit for a little while. Just that took longer than I expected. But I did start ridiculously small.
How did you manage to fund it initially? Did you have
Did you get an investor? Did you have someone just give you money? Like, none
of
that.
I had a little bit of money just from like my mum and dad and my grandparents.
Yeah.
And I was working, so I just kept all the money I was earning, I was spending on the rent here. And I had some savings as well. So, yeah, but I just did it really cheap. I got friends' dads to do welding for me. I got mates to do tiling.
Yeah.
I built heaps of stuff myself, and I just started. Like I said, I started so small that I couldn't have actually possibly made a profit, but at least I could get running. So, yeah.
And how did you go, like, scaling up once you got a foot in the door, so to speak?
I didn't. Mike did. I'd run out of energy by the time Mike joined me, and luckily he was still full of energy, and so he's done the scaling up, basically. Yeah. I was at a point where I just didn't. I'd run out of ideas and run out of energy, and was just plodding along, going, "Oh my God, I don't know what to do from here on in." So, yeah.
Bit of inspiration.
Yeah.
How did you basically find your customers, people that are willing to buy your product, and how did you build your brand and go from there?
Mostly, I found them just by asking the right people. If you walk into Liquorland and try to sell them craft beer, they say, no, go away, or yes, we'll take 10 pallets. Which neither one's going to work for me, obviously, so it's just a matter of knowing the market, I suppose, and knowing which shops are actually going to buy your product.
Yeah.
In terms of like private customers, I don't have to worry about that, because I just sell wholesale. So yeah, just knowing which other businesses are going to buy your stuff, and yeah, that was about it. What was the second part of the question?
About your brand. So how have you made Happy Goblin, you know, well known, and people be happy to have it? So you notice you're in restaurants and stuff now. So.
Yeah, look, I basically haven't. I've never done any marketing other than going into the right bottle shops and the right pubs and stuff and asking them, just purely word of mouth. Again, like I said before, I had a lot of time on my hands. I didn't have, because I had no finance and had no pressure to have to make money quickly, I didn't have to build sales quickly. So I didn't have to, I just let it word of mouth do the job. Just built really, really slowly. And which meant, again, that there was even less pressure on me to, slow growth means no pressure. So I didn't really do anything to build my brand except for just going around. A few little things like going to beer tastings and beer festivals, stuff like that. Just talking shit at every opportunity you get, telling people what you do. That helps. People want beer. Like, people like beer. It's not a hard product to sell. So I'm lucky in that respect. So yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Do you see that you have competition? And what do you do about that?
I'll send a guy out to deal with it. Nah, look, I mean, like I said, like, craft beer at the moment is like wine was 30 years ago. The industry, like, the market just can't get enough of it. In 10 years' time, we'll have competition, but we'll be one of the well-established brands, so we'll be all right. I feel sorry for all the guys starting up now, because or anyone who starts up in the next 10 years. Yeah, because they are coming into a market that is slowly becoming saturated. But yeah, as far as we're concerned, like, there's the more breweries that open and the more craft beer is available, the more consumer awareness there is of the fact that VB isn't the only thing you can drink, and the more people will buy our beer. So it's still at the point where more competition means be a better market and stuff like that, but it won't last forever. But hopefully I'll be all right, because I got in early enough. So yeah.
You are quite a small business in terms of your overall output and what you order from people. So how do you get around the fact that your suppliers are bigger than you and they might sort of overlook you a bit?
Nothing you can do about it. Like, you just deal with it and work within their rules and work within the way that they do business. You can't argue with them. If you say, no, I don't want to do that, they'll just say, oh, well, we're not going to supply you. So, yeah, you just, like, obviously our big suppliers are people like electricity companies and stuff like that. But as far as we're concerned, all our suppliers are the same. They're all bigger than us. So everyone we deal with, we just work to their system, and yeah, that's all right. You know, we don't. I don't like credit anyway. I don't want credit off people because I don't want to be sitting there worrying about when I have to pay for stuff. I'd rather just pay for it up front and know that I don't owe anyone anything. So, but that's why, like I say, I've never had finance. So that's the whole way I've always run the business, is I don't spend what I don't have. So yeah, yeah. So, but that's hard if you don't. If you've got huge setup costs or something like that, then you have to play that game. That's no fun. Yeah.
What are some of the challenges you've faced? Like, you're talking about constantly finding it tough to keep up with orders. I suppose that's a good thing, but how is it also a bad thing?
Oh, we're never far enough behind that it gets bad. But if you start to piss your customers off, they don't order from you anymore.
Yeah.
If they're always waiting 3 weeks to get their beer and then you turn up with 3 cartons when they want 10, they're just not going to bother ringing you next time. But luckily we're never that bad. Luckily we always tell them, we'll see how we go, we might be able to do that for you. And basically we always get them close enough to what they want, and we're never weeks late. Yeah, we always get it to them on time. And just a couple of cartons short. In a way, that's actually good, because that makes it seem like it's hard to get. so yeah. And then, look, that's our main thing. Like I said, just finding the customers in the first place is a bit of a challenge. But no, there's just I suppose managing. I do a few. Look, both of us. I've got 5 different beers that I make. Mike's got 2 or 3 now. So managing a number of different lines is a bit of a problem sometimes, because I'll end up with, you know, so much dark ale that I don't know what to do with it, but then not enough of my normal beer that I just sell every day, and then in 2 months' time I'll have no dark ale but more pale than I can possibly sell in a month. So that's, yeah. That's it. We're pretty. It's a pretty simple business, so we don't have too many problems other than just that. Simple, just management of how much beer you're making and how much beer people want to buy. That's really it. The Corum blows up every now and then. That's a challenge. But that's it.
What makes you successful as a craft brewer versus, you know, the other guys out there trying to do the same thing as you?
I don't know. I mean, well, we're all successful. Really, like, everyone's doing all right in the industry, like I say, because the market's so good at the moment. So, I mean, I suppose what makes us successful is just the fact that we're making good beer, and that's it. We're just, yeah, we're making good beer. We're not trying to cut corners. We're not trying to make it cheaply. And, I mean, and people like just the whole idea of the way our business is, that it's all, like, small scale and homemade and sorry.
Taste test.
Technical testing. Yeah. It's not overdone at all.
No, that's good. Yep. Quality control.
Strict quality control.
Yeah. That's the key to our success. Yeah. Strict quality control.
Where do you see Happy Goblin like in 5 years? Are you gonna still be doing the same kind of stuff, or are you
Yeah, the same but bigger, like, because we are scaling up, like, well, Mike's forcing me to scale up. And yeah, so I mean, eventually this big new tank over here will come online.
Yeah.
And then I'll have to get bigger fermenters to cope with that. And I mean, there's always, the market wants more craft beer. So yeah, we've got to, unless I'm just going to sit here constantly saying no to people, I've got to start making more. So. Yeah, like I would say in 5 years, like, we'll be double our current production at least.
Yeah, wow.
Like, I mean, we could sell twice as much beer tomorrow if we wanted. We could just, yeah, if we could double our production tomorrow, we'd sell it tomorrow. We could double it the next day and sell that again.
Yeah, cool.
So, yeah.
So how are you planning to expand that?
Desperately. Just by knocking together new tanks out of secondhand bits and pieces, and just the same as we've been doing right from the start, just Yeah. No finance. We don't want external finance at all. We're not interested in that. That's that one. All the commitment and the loss of control that's involved with that. That's no good. So just keep just knocking bits and pieces together. And just, I don't know, maybe I'll get a bigger car so I can deliver more beer. This one's about to die, so. more kegs rather than bottles as well. Like, that's where the good margin is in beer. Just a second. Go. No, not enough. Yeah, so I mean, we've been trying to increase our keg production over the last sort of year. At the same time as not take on any new bottle customers, because bottles are easy in a way. Bottles are really easy to sell, because there's bottle shops everywhere, there's cafes everywhere that'll take bottles off you. But there's less margin in them, and there's more work, and the tax, like the excise, is higher. So kegs are harder to sell because there's less outlets, but. Yeah, less work, less tax, more money. Yeah, so, yeah. But, yeah, just finding places to move them is hard. And you lose your kegs occasionally. Occasionally you go to pick up your kegs and you're like, I brought you 4 kegs. Well, I've only got 3 empty ones. And they're like, I don't know. And there you go, you just lost $100. So, wow. Yeah.
So is it kegs where Happy Goblin's going to be going in the future?
More so. Not completely, but yeah. We'll still definitely do bottles, because bottles are your really, really consistent income. Like I say, you can sell bottles easily. There's heaps of customers for them. So yeah, we can just. But you can't stop doing bottles. But yeah, kegs is quick, easy cash. So yeah.
Well, eventually, we had to test Colin's beer for ourselves, which shortened this video a tiny little bit. Anyway, we hope you enjoyed watching and got something out of Colin's inspiring story. And many thanks to Colin, to Mike, and the Happy Goblin, and also to Daniel Winnie for being our step-in sound man during the shoot. See you next time!